Morning, everyone. You can say morning back, guys. It's interactive. Morning. I'm Shay. I use she, her pronouns, and I've just finished studying psychology and language sciences. And this year, I'm your equity and inclusion officer in the Students' Union. So that means I'm here to represent and support those who come from marginalized communities.
Hi, everyone. I'm Jasmine. I'm currently in my third year studying UCL English. Not as exciting as Shay, unfortunately, but here we are. Well, since you're here, and if you're anything like me, you've probably read your department's website, browsed through countless how-to articles, watched YouTube campus tours, and you've probably already been to a few of your departmental inductions. Well, now it's time to hear firsthand from current and former students about what UCL is really like and how to make the most of your student life here.
So, as a university student, you're part of a community of people pulling you all in the same direction. You are a partner in helping make UCL what it is, which is why over the next few weeks you'll see students leading student groups across campus, delivering services such as our cafes and bars, and continue trying to improve the sort of education and student experience that we all get. So it made quite a lot of sense to us to have students up here helping you induct and welcome you to this new and amazing place.
So over the next 40 minutes or so, we'll be covering what we wish we knew, what you need to know, and we'll give you an opportunity to ask questions about what you actually want to know.
So to do the Q&A, we'll be using this fancy thing called Slido. So just to check you guys know how to use it, let's just do a quick check-in on how you're feeling. So feel free to scan the QR code or type in your browser, slido.com, and type in that code. How you doing? I'm aware it's really early on a Tuesday morning, so it's okay if it's not a... someone feels a nine. Ignore what I'm saying. You guys are feeling great. Oh, only one person is live on this, though. Okay, someone's feeling less good. These might be some hangovers, which is why these are lower numbers.
At least there's no one.
Oh, you spoke too soon. Amazing. Okay, so we're kind of at a range, which is completely fine. Amazing, so you guys know how to use this now. So like we said, this is UCL 101 is kind of like a quick tour guide on how to go about your first term and your first year. And so we're starting with what we wish we knew. I think at uni, it's really easy to compare yourself to other people. And I think it's really important to remember that there's no right way to do things. This is in regards to like your academic side of stuff, but also your social life. So like a really easy example of the academic side, I remember coming in to my first year and seeing in lectures, all these people on their Macs typing up their notes. And I had my really crappy HP laptop and was like, cool, this is what I'm meant to do. No information whatsoever went in because that's just not how I learn. And then finally in second term, I was like, this isn't really working out for me. I'm going to ignore what everyone else is doing and handwrite my notes, even if it takes more time, etc. And weirdly enough, I actually started to learn things. So just to keep into perspective that you all learn differently. There's so many of you, you're so diverse, which is incredible. But just remember not to compare yourself to anyone else. Same with social events, obviously welcome. Freshers, there's a huge emphasis on like the clubbing and the bars and the partying side of it, which is great if you really love that stuff. And obviously there's loads of ways for you to get involved with that. But also there's hundreds of daytime events that the SU are running and over 90% of them are sober. So if that's more your vibe, definitely get involved with that. I think the main thing to take away from this idea is go at your own pace. Use this term to figure out what works for you and what doesn't, and stick to that regardless of anyone else. So try not to compare yourself to anyone else or beat yourself up if you think that you're not where you're supposed to be in terms of friends or studying.
It's also definitely worth saying, and this is quite an important thing, 60% and above is actually a really good grade. Shocking. In terms of degree comparisons, I think it's like a 65%, it's a 2-1, which is an A- in America, and then 80% on the China GPA scale, apparently, and not a C. So definitely explain that to your parents if you get a 60 or something. I promise you're doing well.
I think also it's really important to know it's normal for your first assignment to go really bad. Like that makes a lot of sense. You've just come from studying a different qualification, whether that was A-levels or whatever it was, and now you're at university where you're meant to be here, where you're going to be here for like at least 3 years. So that means that it makes sense if your first assignment isn't a first. I remember my first term, our first assignment, we all handed it in, and I think we all got around, like my entire year, we all got around 50%, and we were all like, oh no, this isn't very good. And our course leader got up at the front and was like, this is really good. Like, the whole point of university is that you're here to develop and like refrain your academic skills, and that's what's going to happen. So it makes sense that you're not going to get it on the nail the first time, and that's really normal. So yeah, I think kind of whether you're doing really well academically, you feel, or you're struggling a little bit, I think the most important thing to remember is, like, if you miss something, don't worry, just turn up to the next one. I think people get really caught up in trying to catch up with a class that they might have missed, and then that makes them feel like they can't go to the next one. That is truly not the case. As someone with really bad anxiety, I'm aware that the hardest part is turning up, but also it is the most important part in like various ways. So in regards to your studies, it actually will help your academic work, even if you haven't necessarily caught up on the past thing, because you're able to ask questions and just be in that space and focus your mind. And even with like clubs and societies, it's really important to remember that everyone's in the same boat. Everyone's been a fresher from like the previous years and knows how intimidating it can be to go to your first club or society event. And other people in your year are experiencing that, even if they seem that they're really chill. So yeah, I think kind of touching upon clubs and societies, it's good to talk about sort of using opportunities outside of your course.
Definitely. There is so much more to UCL than just your degree. You should immerse yourself in whatever you can. It's also worth saying that employers tend to want much more than your degree. As someone who's currently doing a lot of job applications, which aren't very fun, they tend to ask about your extracurricular activities and your experiences, and they don't care what you got in uni. They just don't. It's also worth knowing, very fun fact, that Chris Nolan actually went to UCL. As people currently in the back filming this event will probably tell you, they're part of FilmSoc, and Chris Nolan came to UCL, studied English, didn't really enjoy it, but came for FilmSoc, and now he's a very, very famous director, so he's done quite well for himself.
Yeah, some might say. So kind of, yeah, talking about the best place to find these opportunities to do these things are through societies, networks or volunteering. So we've got our welcome fair on this weekend, which is Saturday and Sunday. Tickets went live yesterday. I definitely recommend booking. This basically gives you the opportunity to meet all of our clubs and societies, all the people on the committee, and get to know what they're about, what type of events they do, and whether it's something for you. There's a reason why everyone says to join a society when you come to uni, because it's a really good way to make friends. I'm really aware that coming into first year can be really lonely. You're adjusting from maybe being in a family household to now kind of living independently, which is obviously great in some ways, but can be really lonely. So you're able to make these connections and friendships within societies. And I think what's also really important to mention is you can join societies at any point in the year. So I was someone who was, again, quite anxious when I came to uni. So I remember my welcome fair, I literally had my headphones in. I didn't speak to anyone. I just collected all the freebies. Would recommend the freebies, but also talking to people. And then I sort of only later on in my term started to join societies. And then by the time I ended my university, like my studying part, I'd like had the confidence to join so many more just literally as the opportunities came about. So it's definitely important to remember that. I think Jazz is completely right about using the opportunities to sort of develop a portfolio. So for example, I joined Musical Theatre Society in my first year. In my first term, I assistant produced American Idiot that was put on in the Bloomsbury Theatre right here. I loved producing so much, I carried on doing it to the point where I now do it professionally, freelance, on the side. I did that for my final year next to my degree, which was incredible. So you really don't really realize how incredible the opportunities you're being given are, and you can really develop these skills, and it looks really impressive, and it is really impressive. So I think it's just important to remember that.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I joined during COVID year, so I actually did nothing in my first year. I wasn't in any societies. And then in second year, I got a committee position and started writing for Pi Media, and suddenly I had a life, so.
It's incredible. Also, as I mentioned, if you are interested in putting on a wonderful show in this beautiful theatre, there are so many ways to get involved. You can do it through the art societies, so the ones that perform, or you can do it via stage crew, who are the best society. They literally won Best Art Society of the Year last year. So they are the ones who are in charge, who work with the theatre technicians to help put on the show from behind the scenes. So they'll be at the Welcome Fair on Sunday. So if you want to get involved with that, that can be lighting design, sound design, or set, anything like that. It's super fun. And if you want, if you like performing and like doing behind the stage things, you can do a bit of both, because that's really cool. Cool, so we've kind of covered kind of the breadth of what UCL has to offer, which obviously we're aware that it's a big campus and we're in central London. So we're going to talk to you a little bit about navigating uni online and on campus.
Well, first of all, with understanding your timetable, it will look very, very busy right now. Personally, my department doesn't give us a timetable on UCL timetable because they hate us. They give us things on Moodle that we then have to adjust to, and I have to figure out where my seminars are.
So Moodle is your friend. Moodle, oh my God, is your Moodle best your friend. Honestly, you can access so many resources on it. Would definitely recommend. Like, also, if you've ever missed a class and stuff, there's so many more resources on there than you actually think or that they might actually cover in class. Also, kind of navigating campus physically, would definitely recommend you download UCL Go. It's like an app that you just have on your phone. It can tell you what you can link it to your timetable. You can type where you need to go. It will take you there, basically give you directions. And also, really useful, you can see in like the study spaces around uni how many study spaces are available. So if you're like, cool, I want to go to the student centre, but then see that there's only like 5 seats, you can check out where else there's better seats and head over there.
Please don't go to the student centre, it's already very busy.
It's so busy, especially in exam season. Also, it's open 365 days a year, which is pretty cool. Yeah.
So on to the next part of what you need to know. There's genuinely a lot of support here at UCL, but sometimes we know that it can be a bit overwhelming. The best thing that you can do is to talk to someone early, and we've got a few key solutions to common problems. So with the... obviously, with the cost of living crisis and general London prices, we know that life as a student can be a stretch.
So kind of wanted to talk about part-time work. It's quite normal to study and have a part-time job. I personally did it in my final year. I was studying and balancing 2 part-time jobs. There's also various ambassador programs on campus and loads of jobs within the Students' Union, which offer like flexible working hours. So kind of the way that it works is you put in your studies and your timetable, and then your shifts are, your studies are always prioritised, basically, so it's never, you're never going to be given a shift when you have work, which is really cool and flexible. You can find all of these opportunities on the Job Shop, which is on the Student Union website, which I would definitely check out. They all pay at least London Living Wage, which is really great. And also, so many students get involved as student staff, which means it's a really nice environment, because the Student Union is obviously by the students for students. So it's a great way, again, to make connections and meet people.
Just to also add, they do also hire in all the cafes and bars on campus as well, and they also pay London Living Wage and will work around your schedule. And I think they start hiring from about now.
Yeah, definitely check that out. The bars are really fun.
We've also recently launched a cost of living hub with loads of advice. So you can talk to student funding advisors to help with money management, student finance. All you have to do is book an appointment through Ask UCL. There's also a financial assistant fund that you can apply for that will help with living costs. Sorry, just need to flip over. The Students' Union actually also have a society participation fund, which will help pay for memberships, events, or equipment, especially with sports clubs and that sort of thing. They tend to be very, very expensive. So they can definitely help you out. And you can apply for these whether you are a home student or an international student. So really, it's available for everyone.
I think what's really important to mention with the Society Participation Fund is that the society in question won't know that you've accessed that fund in order to take part in the activities. So it really is completely confidential. It will just go between you and the SU. They'll send you the money and then you're able to buy the equipment and get involved. So yeah. No, you go.
Okay. Well, it's just, we know that juggling like new financial responsibilities and suddenly this whole new life at uni, it can be really difficult. If you need any academic support, it is there, and your first point of call should be your department. Your tutors, your lecturers, they tend to have office hours. Please use those.
Honestly.
I mean, everyone tells you that when you come to uni. I didn't use those, honestly. I barely use them in second year, but I definitely will be using them this year.
Yeah, again, someone, I remember I came to uni and they were like, use your office hours. I was like, you want me to sit in a room with an academic for a lecture that I probably have not been to? Absolutely not. But then I did it in my final year, because that's when you get so desperate. You're like, I don't have anxiety about this. I just need help. And it actually really helped. I got a first in that module. So apparently it's not a myth. It really does help to go to your office hours. This is whether you're struggling with something or whether you're really interested in something and you're like, cool, I want to do a bit more extra reading or maybe like look into this a bit more. They're really there to support you and help you. So would definitely recommend office hours.
And normally your tutors actually really love it if you talk to them about stuff they're interested in. So if you sort of catch them after a lecture or, you know, you sort of just walk into their office, they normally are really, really happy to have a chat.
You can also do it via Teams as well, which is like a little bit less stressful because it's just via a screen and it's literally like 15, you book like a 15 minute slot and it can make such a difference.
Yeah. Or pop them an email, that works too, yeah. Also make sure you talk to your transition mentors. I'm not sure if they've gotten in touch yet, but basically transition mentors are students on your course in their second and third year and they are there to help you sort of transition into university. They really understand your coursework and your course load. They've all been there, so they would be a really good point of call.
Completely, like they've literally been in your shoes the year before, so they're able to help you out and would definitely recommend using them. Again, they have weekly meetings. If you miss one, that doesn't matter. Just go to the next if you do have questions.
I also believe there's like a writing lab on Moodle that you can access. Coming to university, the style of writing you need can be really, really different, regardless of what degree you do, and that's just something that could help you out, so definitely check it out.
So now we've just kind of covered academic support. Obviously we're aware that things happen, unexpected serious events happen, which might sort of inhibit your ability to study. If this happens, you are able to apply for an extenuating circumstance. So you have to kind of apply for your EC within a week of it happening, and then you can be granted up to a week extension on any piece of work that you have upcoming. Please use ECs. I think people have some weird thing about shame with trying to get an extension. They're there for you for a reason. Like, you genuinely might need them. I personally had to use loads, like within my final year and my COVID year, because I was dealing with some other stuff. But also, if you have a disability or a long-term mental health illness, you're entitled to a SORA, which is like a statement of reasonable adjustment. So this essentially means, I'll cover this a little bit more later, but basically you contact SSW, who is Student Support Wellbeing, explain to them said disability or long-term mental health condition, you provide them with some medical evidence, and then basically they sort of adjust the way that you're kind of treated, I guess, within your studies. So for example, my SORA, because I suffer with depression, that included like a blanket week extension for everything, because I might not be able to do it for the deadline. Also, like, they go through a list of things. It can, for another thing that I had was like, I was able to leave a lecture hall without the lecturer calling me out in case I thought I was having a panic attack. But also, if you've got like ADHD, you can ask for the slides for lectures to be sent beforehand so you have time to process them. So again, if you have a long-term mental health condition or disability, please do get a SORA. They help so much. I personally only got mine in my final year, which was so silly, and it really, really helped. So yeah.
So if you aren't really sure who to go to help, we have student advisors, which are fully trained members of staff that are on hand to help you with everything wellbeing and student experience related. They are in your department and are trained in the resources we offer, and then you can also find them online. And if you're not sure you want to speak to someone at UCL, because we know it can be intimidating to speak to someone in your department, the SU Advice Service is actually independent to UCL?
Yeah, so the SU Advice Service is great, it's free, it's confidential, and it's independent to UCL, and it has basically an experienced team who are able to give you support on an advice on money, academic issues, housing, employment, personal and uni matters. So I would definitely recommend, you're able just to book an appointment with them either online or have like a phone call with them. They're also found on the first floor of 25 Gordon Street as well. Yeah, I guess we've kind of discussed transition mentors and how important they are to use. They can also be a great way to just sort of get advice from another student who can signpost you to where you might need to go if you're not sure. But also we've got the SSW that I mentioned. So this is a team that provides safe and confidential space to discuss any well-being issues, mental health or disability concerns that might be affecting your ability to study. You're able to request a same-day appointment with them via Ask UCL, which we mentioned beforehand. Ask UCL is basically kind of like the UCL helpline, where if you just like report, basically go on that, you can kind of find how your next steps for any issue. The SSW team also are able to offer you free short-term individual counselling. So to access this specific support, you need to complete a registration form, which you can find online. Shortly, you'll have like an initial consultation to discuss your needs and what the issue is, and then you might have like 6 weeks of counselling given to you. So yeah, I guess kind of the main thing about all these support services that we've mentioned is that they're all free and confidential. So your parents, your course mates, your lecturers, these people won't know, and they don't have the ability to ask whether you've accessed them or not. I think it's quite important where if you kind of, as a first stop, like a first port of call, if you start with your student advisor, because you're able to have that, they're there for you. So you're able to have a conversation with them on the day and help figure out your next steps. I think it's really easy to get, to let things build and to feel really overwhelmed, and then it kind of explode in that way. But again, these services are there for you for a reason, so please do use them and don't wait to reach out for help, because they've been put in place to be able to support you, so you're able to feel, look after your well-being, essentially.
Yeah, absolutely. So, now that we've covered everything that we think you should know, it's time for you to tell us what you want to know. So we've got Slido opening up, I believe. You can sort of scan the code, submit your questions. We'll answer as many as we can in the time that we have. Reasonable questions, please. And then if we can't sort of get around to them, I think they'll go up later on the new student's website.
Yeah. Should I carry my BRP with me at all times?
Absolutely not.
Absolutely not.
It will cost like £1,000 to replace it. It's not a good idea. Same with your passport, don't carry that around. We tend to recommend either like the UK driver's license, which I think costs, I don't know, £40, or there's like a totem card that you can either pick up. You can order online or pick up in any post office. It's also a photo ID. They are accepted in most places. That costs like 10, 20 quid.
Cool. How many societies should I join? So, I think it really depends on you as a person. It depends on, obviously, your interests. There's no point joining loads of societies for the sake of it. I personally only joined, like, one properly in my first year. But then by the time that I left UCL, I joined, like, most of the arts ones. So I think it kind of depends. I think start with one or two. Check out some of the events. The amazing thing about Welcome Week is that like most of our clubs and societies are offering like taster membership, free membership for a little while, so you can basically check it out, see if you like the vibe, see if you want to commit to it a bit more and buy the joining fee. So yeah, I think it kind of just depends, but what I would, yeah, it's up to you whether you kind of want to, I think people either go like one or two really committed or do like a few and like kind of dip in and out. So yeah.
When should I start looking for accommodation for second year? Not now. That's for sure.
Aren't any other English uni in that way. I think other unis, they get caught up in like everyone comes to freshers and you have to. I remember my sister like had decided her house by October in her first year, and I was like, this is outrageous. You don't know these people. But yeah, we've done. It's much more chill. It's kind of up to you. I think most people sort of look from May onwards. I'm saying that as someone who looked in July and moved in August. So yeah, it kind of depends on what you want to do.
It's also definitely not worth looking now, because anything you see now will be gone in a month.
Honestly.
So the general sort of turnaround period for London is a month before you want to move in.
Completely, yeah. Cool. How do you join societies?
On the SU website.
Yeah. Basically, you just go on the SU website, type the club or society that you want, and then you're literally able to just buy membership. It's important to note as well that we've got networks. So a couple of networks that I oversee is like Women's Network, BME Network, LGBTQ+ Network, Trans Network, and Disabled Students Network. So definitely check them out. Those are completely free to join as well. And so we've got events coming up throughout the year, socials, and kind of the aim of the networks is just to create like a really safe space for people who have maybe a similar lived experience. So I'd definitely check them out, because also I'll be there. So yeah.
In terms of student discounts, I would say most places, in terms of restaurants, you just have to ask whether they have a student discount. There's no shame in it. I do it everywhere.
Honestly, just do it.
You literally just ask, and if they say no, well, that's that. But in terms of online ones, definitely look at UniDays. Has everything. Other than UniDays, a lot of stores participate in student beans.
Yeah.
So I'd say that's the two main ones you definitely want on hand at all times.
I agree. Just thinking near campus, Japanese Canteen on TCR, which is a go-to lunch place. They take student discount, and Rose's Thai, which is down on Warren Street as well. When should we start applying for internships?
Now.
I think it kind of depends on what you want to do. Kind of just depends on what you want to do. I know loads of people who have graduated and are super successful that did an internship. I know loads of people who are super successful and have graduated that did not do an internship. So it really depends on kind of what career you think you want. Also, the sort of bandwidth that you have, it's quite hard. Like, I don't envy Jazz for doing job applications whilst trying to study. Like, it's quite hard to do internship applications whilst in time. So I think, again, that's one of them ones where it's like, go at your own pace, choose what you think is right for you. Don't get caught up in this whole internship spring week nonsense. Like, it's really kind of whatever you want.
I would also say don't worry about it in your first year. Applications do open now for anyone who's extra eager. And then they sort of tend to close over the next few months if you want to start for next summer. But realistically, your first year, this summer of your first year probably is one of your last summers ever.
Have fun, honestly.
So have fun, go traveling, and then worry about it in your second year, because that's when you might want to start thinking about internships.
Amazing. What? Oh, this is a really nice question. What's your favourite thing or experience from UCL, Jazz?
Well, I'm on Film Society. I'm treasurer of this year.
Cheeky plug.
Exactly. Make sure you come on Saturday. I will be there to say hi to everyone. That was definitely one sort of big experience for me that I really enjoyed, because I got to work on several film sets, you know, organize lots of activities. We had a film festival last year that we did. That was really, really exciting. And I think we'll have it again this year. So
amazing. Yeah. I think for me, as you guys get to know me this year, you'll realize that I'm really pro arts. So last year I was arts officer, which is like a part-time role. I think one of the best things I've done is put on a production of Rent here in the Blooms. I did that last year, my final year. It was incredible. For those who don't know, Rent centers like queer people of color in the storyline. And also I put on a performance showcase, an exhibition for Black History Month last year as well, which was really cool in the Cloisters. And I've got another one coming up later on at the end of October, so definitely check that out. I think if you ask most people, they'll probably reference something they've done in a club or society or network. But obviously some people, like, their favourite thing is the academia, and that's obviously completely valid as well. How to study a second language? It's kind of to do with societies. So first of all, check if something's in your course involved in that. You can ask your course leader if you're able to do that as part of your course. If you're not, you can join Spanish Society, for example. They do, like, I think if you buy the membership, you get basically, you're entitled to free classes to learn the language, same with like French Society and stuff like that. So definitely just check out the societies, the language societies, basically, the cultural ones.
How much should you prep for lectures, seminars, or tutorials?
I didn't prep at all in my first year, to be brutally honest. Again, I think it depends on you. I think for tutorials and seminars it helps, because you want to be able to feel like you can speak. Because again, it depends on your department. So like my department was pretty lax in the sense of like, if you didn't want to speak, they wouldn't make you. But I know like in other departments, they'll be like, cool, this person, what do you think of this? And you kind of just have to speak.
My department's mean like that. Yeah. So I would generally say lectures, no one's going to call on you. But seminars and tutorials, have something in your bag. If you don't, it's fine, but have something.
Yeah, even if it's just like, if you're reading an academic paper, for example, even if you're just reading the abstract, be like, I roughly know what this point of this is. How important are first year exams? So I don't know about your, I think your first year didn't count.
Mine counted for nothing.
Yeah, so it depends on your department. So I remember, because a couple of my best mates did English, so our first year was very funny, because my first year did count, but it counted for like 1/9, so it really doesn't count that much. So there's a contrast of that. They're not important, really. I don't know why I stuttered about that. They're not. But obviously study if you want.
It will help you build up sort of your academia portfolio, in the sense that your first, sort of your second and third year will build up upon your first year. So we're not saying don't study, we're just saying if you sort of don't do well on one, it doesn't really matter.
Yeah. First year is really about like the connections that you make and your student experience. I think socially is slightly more important than the academia side, because it's your second and third year that really count, and that's when you feel settled and have really got into things and like know who you, what you want to do and stuff like that. Best place for coffee on campus. We have so many cafes on campus. Student Union cafes, we got Gordon's in 25 Gordon Street. We have the Blooms Cafe literally in this building, right there. We've got the stuff in the Lewis building, so the building with the Huntley print room. There's loads, basically, and they're all subsidised because we're students, so it's slightly cheaper. And anything that you put, basically all the money that you spend in, like, the SU cafes and bars, it goes back into the SU, so we're able to, like, do more things. So, yeah. It's cheap and good.
I also think if you bring like your own cup, you get 25p off or something like that. And or you get charged more if you have a disposable cup, so yeah. You might as well.
Is it possible to attend lectures outside your department? So, kind of no, basically, only because we had this question yesterday. What it is like, for each class, for each lecture, it's been put in that room for a certain reason, for like to do with maximum capacity and like health and safety reasons. So if they haven't accounted for you being there, that's not great. Also, you need to put it into perspective of like someone is paying their fees specifically for those modules or for that course, in the same way that you are for your degree and your course. So yeah. Is there Wi-Fi at campus? Absolutely.
Yes.
EduRoam. Login. Basically, it's your weird login with like the Z. Stuff like your six-letter one at UCL, blah blah, and then your password, and that should get you Wi-Fi at any university in England, which is pretty cool. So if you're up to Edinburgh, you still got it. That's not England, sorry. But if you go anywhere, you basically can still access the Wi-Fi there.
Any recommendations for apps or websites for studying? Did you have any?
Connected Papers, but I don't know if you guys. Yeah, Connected Papers is really good, basically. You put in the title of your paper, it shows you the ones, either the papers that have come before or after it, and kind of like the relevance of them. Would definitely recommend, was a game changer for my essays. Do international students have access to the welfare bursaries and funds? I am not sure about the UCL ones. You'll be able to find that out on UCL's website. To the Society Participation Fund, absolutely. If you check out the cost of living hub on the SU website, that basically breaks down each of the single funds and tells you who's eligible for them and like the criteria and stuff. So definitely check that out.
Sorry, I just want to jump back to the thing about resources and websites. Do you actually use the library resources online? Because that's how I find all my papers when I write essays. It tends to be better than JSTOR or Google, so definitely check that out. Because they've got a lot of papers on there and a lot of online resources that you otherwise wouldn't be able to access.
They really do. Can you do a taster session? So this kind of depends. We have like a kind of refreshers in the start of term two, so January, February. So you'll notice that some clubs and societies will be doing taster membership there again, just to increase engagement for their events and stuff. So you can definitely wait for that. Where can I find the welcome fair ticket link? Literally just Google Students Union UCL. As soon as you click on it, it says book your welcome ticket. You can book for one day. It's on Saturday and Sunday. Average society membership fee.
Oh, that's a wide range.
Yeah, I think it depends because obviously you get, so the sports ones I think are more expensive. Basically it depends because it depends what the activity that club and society does. So I think for like a society that maybe uses less resources, like I don't know, so please don't quote me on this because Reading Society might have a really expensive fee, which they won't because it's a student union. But so theirs probably more is cheaper because like you're probably bringing in your own books, you're doing that stuff. Whereas like if you're playing sports, you might have to register for various things, and so it might be slightly more expensive.
I would say anything to do with equipment tends to be more expensive. So with sports clubs and stuff, it's because of the uniform and the equipment that it's so expensive. I think with art societies, it can be slightly more expensive if you're doing anything very, very technical.
Yeah.
Just because they need to fund that.
It basically just depends, but you can find out the joining fees of every single society on the website as well. I definitely would recommend, I remember I did it in my first term, literally just going on the website, scrolling through all of them, anyone that I kind of was interested in, I just checked out the page. Okay, I think I really want to end on the how long did it take you to settle in one, so let's just do the what career services are available.
I'm pretty sure your department has like sort of a careers advisor in every single one.
Yeah,
that would
does.
Be a very good first point of call. They will help you look at your resume, cover letter, everything. and they can give you advice on like what your people in your department tend to go on doing, and they've seen lots of people just like you, so.
Completely, that's definitely a great first contact. Also, we have UCL Careers, so they've got a website, definitely hit that up. It was really good for me in my second year when I was really confused. You can book like a 15-minute consultation, basically, where you can be like, I really want to do this, how do I do this? Or you can be like, I really don't know what I want to do and I don't know what my next steps are, and they can sort of talk you through. They also do things like CV workshops, develop your skills. They've got talks from various people. I'm trying to organize like one, for example, for Black History Month, which is like specific to like successful black people in various industries. So yeah, I definitely just keep an eye on UCL Careers. Yeah, Jazz, how long did it take you to settle in?
That's a difficult question. I mean, it sort of goes back to the whole definitely go as your own pace, go at your own pace, and everyone's very different. I think for me, it was rough because my first year was mostly in lockdown, so there wasn't really much settling in I could do. I had a very nice room because of it, but I would say I really sort of found my footing, I guess, really in second year. But yeah. I sort of, you do get used to campus within the first few months, I think.
Yeah. Yeah, I think it obviously depends. I think I can look back at my first year and I think I was pretty comfortable by the time I came into second term. So obviously I'd done American Idiot here, which was amazing, and then I was doing Legally Blonde, which was also being put on in the theatre in second term. So I kind of knew people and had made those connections and friendships through like societies. But I then look at the difference between, for example, last year as my final year and how comfortable and confident I was then. So I think it really does just vary. There's no rush to make friends. Like, it will happen. There's no point. I think it's like a whole meme of, like, the first people you meet on your first day of freshers, you probably won't know by the end of your time at uni. So, yeah, I think it really depends. But it's really, I remember even though I had like a friendship group by the time I'd finished first term, like you still feel lonely. So yeah, I would say kind of just as the years go on, you get more and more comfortable. Obviously that's not to say that you're going to feel weird in your second year. Yeah, so I think it just depends.
Yeah, that's a pretty good answer.
Amazing. Last question. How useful have you found this talk? Bear in mind, I can see the answers.
Yeah, please don't give us a one. That would hurt a little bit.
Oh, as you said that, someone did. Gutting.
That's a bit mean. Yeah. Oh, are we going to wait for him to come through? I guess that's kind of it.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, we hope you've had a chance to get involved with all the welcome activities throughout the week. I think there were quite a lot going on last week as well. And make sure you book a free ticket to this weekend's welcome fair. Again, I will be there on Saturday, so you can drop by and say hi.
I'll be there Saturday and Sunday, overseeing all of the network stalls, so definitely come say hi if you, want to.
Also, I believe the SSW have a fair going on every day until Friday in the Student Centre, where you can meet support staff and get involved with crafts, hug a support dog. There are also support services fairs running from the 26th to 28th of September, from 10:30 until 3 in the North Cloisters. There, they can talk to you about IT support, academic communication, finance careers, SU stalls like volunteering, active bystander, international student support, and apparently the library's there as well. As in, like, the library staff, not the actual library. And if you go to 10 stalls, I believe you could win your first shop. It's a £50 Sainsbury's voucher, which I would argue is about 2 shops, but...
So definitely go to 10 stalls. again... Most important thing to take away from this is there's no right way to do things this week. You don't have to do everything this week. Welcome events and induction things will be occurring next couple of weeks. And again, you're always invited to get involved with anything at offer at UCL throughout your time. There's no right way to do this week, this term, this year. It's kind of going at your own pace, figuring out what works for you. It's really amazing that you're at the start of your journey at UCL. I'm extremely jealous as I enter my fourth year. And I hope that you take on board all of the support services that we kind of signposted to you, because they're here to support you every step of the way. So, yeah.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, guys.
Everyone.
Amazing. If you are all able to leave via the left-hand side, hopefully I will see you guys on Saturday and Sunday. Come say hi to me at the Welcome Fair if you see me on campus, and have a great rest of your week.